Hello, good afternoon everybody. I'm happy you came all over here on this sunny afternoon and sit here in this dark room. this breakout session at the DataWorks Summit. My name is Gerard Messelink. I'm a solution engineer for the data automation team at KPN in the Netherlands. I want to talk about the journey that we made the last 2 years on our Hadoop cluster, on our Hortonworks Hadoop cluster. KPN is a supplier of telecommunication and IT services, and we offer our customers fixed and mobile connections, internet and television. For business customers, KPN offers complete telecommunication and IT solutions, and also KPN has some worldwide wholesale activities, network services for other operators. So there's a whole range of services that that we give to customers. So, where do we come from? It is a few years ago that the BI landscape, it was set up as a big data warehouse, and there were a few important source systems integrated into this common data model, and the work was done project-based, and if there was a need of data, it came to one of the 20 teams that we had, and they could build a solution on it, and they made something that it integrates into this big data warehouse and stuff like that. Well, and at the same time, we see that there was a lot of more data coming to us, so we got a lot of more sources and a lot of more source systems, because KPN acquired all kinds of companies and small businesses that did business with business users and stuff like that, and they all came with their own systems and the source systems, and well, it was a very fast growing set of different data sets that we had to manage. So what happened about 2 years ago? The whole IT at KPN needed some change, and I think in the rest of the world we see this change at all the big companies happen. It is a change for a big transformation, agile transformation. And the organization started to change from the project matrix organization into the agile teams. And still, we are changing. There's a roadmap for the next 3 years to even make it more self-steering and make it, the organization more flexible as it is now. So, together with this organizational change, there started the need of changes in the platforms that we were using. So the teams should get into control. Instead of ordering hardware for each project, you want a flexible way to use your infrastructure. So we set up an infra team with a vision that we want to do actually everything as a service. We want to get these teams, well, using these platforms as a service, make things available as a service. So everything like infrastructure, platforms, applications, everything as a service. It should be a paved road for these development teams to get all their basic needs. That was the basic thought about it. So for example, like Git service to create repositories, Jenkins service, test environments, everything you need in a development team to get started. That was provisioned in that way. And also the platforms were created, and we started building up this new way of working in the infra teams. Same time, there was a massive amount of new sources. I guess we have some more than 100 source systems at the moment at KPN. And the need to use this source data in all kinds of processes. But what you actually saw this 2 years ago was that the process was quite the same for most of the stuff that we did. It was all about some source system, it has some customer data, some order data, some standard stuff, like it delivers some services. And the thing that we did was get it in a data lake, get it integrated into the data warehouse. And actually the patterns seem quite similar for a lot of sources. Although all these teams were doing it a little bit different and using different technologies, and well, there were standards, but they were forced from architects. They told them how to do stuff, but they were not, yeah, well, they were interpreted by the development teams. So, let's see. That's why we need tools to automate this. But, well, we want to automate this, so we said, well, we need a framework for this, we need to standardize it, we need to get a new way of working. We've seen these patterns, like we have a pattern to get all these sources. And at the same time, we had a data lake, and it was totally empty. So there was a data lake set up, a Hadoop cluster set up, and, well, at that time we decided it could be a good moment to switch and to make sure that all the new things that we are doing, that we do it through the data lake. So get all your sources through the data lake, that all these sources can be available for everyone, and that we can use these sources, because there was also a demand from analytics from all kinds of places where they wanted the data, of course. And we actually, ourselves, were completely unsure about the technology. We had no clue, like, how do we do stuff? What are the real standards in this world? What do we do for security? What do we do for data protection? What should we do for data quality? We had actually no clue. And still, we wanted to start all the sources getting in there and start working on it. Well, that was a bit contradictional. So we could spend 2 years designing it and then tell them, well, you can start now, we have a design for it. Well, we want to move in a more agile direction. So that was what we did. And we started the framework and we started it simple. And the basic thing was, well, if you see all these patterns and they all do quite the same, maybe instead of writing code for all these sources, we can start writing templates for these sources, like templates for everything, for the scripting, for all the things that we need to develop for get a source from delivered by a source system into the data warehouse, the whole flow, through the data lake, stored in the data lake, and ended up in the data warehouse. That's where we started the Kettle framework. So that was really the start, and there were, well, like 20 teams that want to use this. So, yeah. So we needed to specify metadata about all these sources. First, let me show the way we organized it, like we made the standard and we split the standard in the three patterns that you saw, like the Hadoop pattern and the BRE pattern and the data model pattern. And the first pattern is about the data lake structure. So we want all these different sources that deliver in different types of ways. We want to get them, well, delivering on the landing zone of this system. So we need some way for all these old systems because they all do CSV files and they dump it every night. And we have some way to move it into this platform. So we need a landing zone that can be populated with the files that are delivered. And we need a backup of all these files also. So that was also set up in the infrastructure. Then next, we in the Hadoop cluster itself, we made the raw zone. And we see the raw zone as a part where we just dump everything that comes in as is, because you want to be sure that if you made a mistake or do some translation wrong or do something, well, something miss something there, that you always can recover from this raw zone and recreate your data lake again. So no reprocessing on this zone. Data, we don't delete the data there unless there is a requirement for expiry. And the schema is applied here on the, based on the metadata that we provided. And we automatically create all the tables on top of it. Well, this is less efficient, but it's still Well, it's AZFS, so it's highly scalable, and we can store a lot of stuff there. Then the next zone, because raw is a bit hard to read for all processes, and we needed a way to store a structured representation of the raw data. And raw data can also be in different formats, so it can also be an XML file, or it can also be a JSON file, or other formats, so it's probably hard to read for all kind of processes. So we made a core zone where we really do the history of all these files that are loaded in. So we create partitions, history partitions on it, that you can easily find the right data in this zone. Still, we don't apply any business logic. It's still exactly the source data as is. It's only partitioned, compressed, and optimized to read, and so for further processing. And we do some data quality checks on it, because here we can see the data really structured in a table, and we can do checks on it. And we can do the data governance and lineage on it, and audit, well, whatever is in there. Then the core zone has all these history partitions and all the data, and it depends on your usage what you want to do with it. Like if you send log files and you want a view of 30 days of logs as something that you need in your business, then the mirror zone can give you that view on top of this core data. So the mirror is more the actual view at the moment, so we can actually make multiple views, also historical views, like how was it 30 days ago, and stuff like that. But it is meant as an actual view on the data as it is. And apart from that, we see a pattern like use this real source data and put it in some data mart and do some things on it, especially for the analytics teams. They want to use sometimes the real raw data from the source system and not some data warehouse version of it that is stored somewhere else. But they see benefits in data that is there and that's maybe missing in the data warehouse then. So that's the demand for the data mart zone. So that was the whole pattern of the Hadoop data lake, and that's actually preparing all the data, storing it, making it useful, making it ready to be used for the next step, where we do the transformation into the data warehouse model. So this layer, this BRE layer, that's about transformation. That's the transformation layer. And what we see is that we have all our metadata specifications from the mirrors. We know how the data looks like from the source systems. We have a CLDM model, and that's actually managed in an Erwin modeling tool. And from the Erwin modeling tool, we import the schemas and the definitions into our tool to do the mapping between them. And we split it up. We split it up in three steps. The first step is still for one source system. It's not integrating with other source systems. It's just the context of one source system itself. And it is about changing the data from the source system by filtering it, aggregating it, sorting it, having some case statements, have some calculations, and move it into the format that we actually use in the data warehouse. But it's not yet really like the database of the data warehouse. It's a preparation database that prepares the data to be in the exact format, the same fields, as the data warehouse. And making it little steps like this, it is something that you can template, and something that you can specify, and something that you can automate. So making it small steps makes this process automatable. Then we have the TPL, the target publishing layer. That's where we do the integration. So we have multiple sources delivering orders. We need to integrate them. You need some key management to get the proper keys on top of it. You have data standardization, that the data is actually, well, the translated into the fields that you need in the data warehouse. Some exception handling. So here we integrate all these sources together into something that can be delivered into the data warehouse. And data warehouse itself, that's more about storing it, having history, doing the delta management, loading it into the data warehouse and stuff like that. So that's where we finish in the CLDM. Now the good thing about a metadata specification, that is that if you write metadata specifications, then and you use that really to create your code, then that's the real truth. Then it's not something in between, it's not some document that you pass on to the developer, like, yeah, it should be like this. No, it's this specification is translated into code, so it will match exactly what you meant. So it should be possible to execute this, so it can be read in by program. And there's less risk of misunderstanding because you really put it down. But a format for metadata, what we do in a development pipeline, we usually produce code, we check it into a Git repository, it goes some pipeline, it goes to production. So this is really meant for this pipeline, for going to production. What we bring it down to is that this format is easy to read, so it's text-based, it's diffable, it's mergeable, it is in version control, and these specifications are, you can do all the things that you do in Git, like discussing it in a pull request. You can tell, like, here is some change on it. I think this data type should be integer or something like that. You can start discussions on it, and you can manage the changes because we see a continuous flow of changes of all these specifications of data sets, and all these source systems are also evolving and changing all the time and changing the interfaces. So we see continuously change over there in all these specifications and in the code that we need to handle these source systems. So that's why we need a process like this with metadata that is readable and easy to understand for everyone. And everyone is able to review it in a Git repository. So here we have the steps in this process. You can see, well, we still use Informatica for some bits. We come from place where we had Informatica and Teradata only, and we had all the processes running over there. And we're actually moving these processes into Hadoop, into the data lake, but we're, it's a process that can change. For scheduling of all this kind of stuff, we use Airflow. The big benefit of Airflow is that it is programmable, so you can create your flows in code. And if it's programmable as code, they can also generate code that is useful for Airflow. So we generate all these Airflow flows based on the metadata and on the pattern that we use, and it creates the whole flow for Airflow. Then we have some preparation before we get some data into the data lake. And there we get some metadata in, into version management. And it's just a real development pipeline. Like, you check in your metadata, it starts a build process, like it's a Git trigger, just a Jenkins build, is building it, it's using the metadata, it's using the templates. And we have automated deployment. You have some layer of governance and monitoring. Here you see, well, you check something into version management, it gets into Git. Git triggers Jenkins. Jenkins starts a build. The build result, it can be SQLs, HQLs, directory structures, all kinds of scripts. It's generated, it's published into Hadoop and into all the layers that we have. Also the Hadoop code, flows for Informatica, they all will get distributed to all the different platforms. The schedules for Airflow are created and published to Airflow. You have Python scripts for data quality that are created and transfer code to get, well, to load data from one environment to another. And this is about the control of it. Yeah, that's where we implement things like lineage logging, so all the things are set up like that. So this is all from the aspect of development. So it's, if we talk about this metadata, it's not about Atlas and stuff like that, but it's about development metadata, about your development process. It actually looks a bit like that, so we're looking like, can we generate Atlas out of it, the metadata that we create, so it's a nice, we saw some nice demonstrations of Atlas. So this gives us the flexibility that with these templates, we can change. So if you want to change over all the sources and we want to move some layer from Oracle into Hortonworks, then we can do that. And we can build scripts that create Spark jobs out of it instead of Informatica jobs. So we are in control of the whole framework, and the teams that are using it are just specifying the metadata for it instead of creating all the code for it. But, of course, they will get a bottleneck. If all these teams, they want something and they want more features than you can build as an automation team. So that's where we choose to do it in a sort of open source way. Like the framework is published and it's given back to all these teams. And the teams can also develop on the framework. So they can also do the pull requests on the framework itself, on the templates. They can review it, they can see how it works, they can see all the steps that are made in the templates. So that's an important thing that all these teams can contribute and are not getting stuck by some automation or by some supplier that has to implement something. If you need it, you can do it yourself. And it's open to use for all these teams. Then we have platforms. So we have all the platforms where stuff is running for CI/CD, for the scheduling, for Power Center stuff, Hadoop environments, integration environments, monitoring environments. That's a whole landscape of servers and of things that needs to be ready to do this. So that's the other layer. This was the development layer, so get your development code on it. The other layer is from operations, how to configure all these environments and make sure that they do what you want to do. That's why we use Ansible. And Ansible, it's a bit like our template module. It's also using templates to configure your environment. And it's also using data for specific environments. So you can set up data for the production, for the test environment, for the develop environment, and set all the properties that are specific for these environments. And you can configure in all kinds of ways your environment. So that's what's happening with Ansible. It's actually also a repository. So it's a repository of all the Ansible configurations, and it's also open for the teams to do pull requests on that. So if they think some configuration should or can be changed, they can do pull requests on the same Ansible repository. So that's what we have. We have a sort of framework set up in an open source style It is still corporate, but in an open source style that all these teams can contribute into it. We have Git repositories for Ansible. We have a template repository that contains all the templates for code. And actually, this repository is important as the, well, our architect is looking into it. Like, what do we exactly do? What are the standards? Because if you generate a table, you need some extra fields. And in the template is that the fields are always there. So stuff like that is in this template repository. Then we have the metadata repository. That's where the teams add new sources and specifications of new sources. And we have a testing repository that can automatically test stuff in the whole environment, because it's still a complex environment and people do changes, and you need to validate that everything is still all right. So we use the standard way of pull requests in the Git repository. It's really good to do pull requests and to discuss really about the lines of code in your pull requests and get all your developers together and make sure that they work together, because that was actually more the issue. Teams were not working together, and now they are forced to review their work and work together through Git and through one repository where they have to update the standards instead of creating their own standards. So you can create your own standards, but you have to get it into the repository and you have to get the community using these standards with you to do so. Well, and standard Git, so the branching model, we actually change the branching model quite often, like every few months we reconsider, well, we can do it a bit better. We create branches for this, or and it triggers on which environments things will deploy and where things can be tested. We also improve the tests that are on top of it, that they perform better and run faster, because that's also important if you have a pipeline like this to improve all these kind of aspects. So for the infrastructure, we have also another SaltStack repository for some core infrastructure, and Ansible for more the application-like infrastructure. What's next? We're busy with automating the Ranger rules, because we think, well, a lot of stuff we already know, so we can push some stuff in Ranger. Saw some nice stuff about Atlas, so still a bit in doubt, like, should we go through Atlas to do this, or should we go directly? Well, now we do directly Ranger ruling. We're busy with row-level tagging, because we integrate a lot of sources, and we have properties on row-level that are actually privacy compliancy and legal compliancy that some people can see or not see some rows. That's a part that we're working on. We're extending the framework, so the whole data mart transformation model is something that can be improved, and we work on a user interface to help the users to fill in this metadata, because you have a lot of parameters that you can set and you need some information about what the parameters mean and how you can use it and how you can use your templates. Little example in code. This is on the infrastructure repository, on the Ansible repository. This is like how a team can add their source to the infrastructure. And this means that if a team comes up with a new source, they don't need to go to the environment teams, but they can do a pull request with only this change in it. And they can say, well, I want to create some CRM system on our environment. What it means is that the operator, so the environment teams, they just have to approve the pull request and say, well, okay, this is a simple change, it's only some new system, no impact, we approve it, and it will run all the scripts, it will create all the folder structures, all the all the things in Hadoop that are necessary. So Based on this, we also create the ranger rules for all these groups. So the groups are matching our LDAP server. And we create all the, well, we don't want to different teams to see each other's data because there is some legal things about it for all the teams to do this. But this is a template to generate Ranger JSON. And the metadata itself, that is for metadata, how you describe your source. This is an example of some field definition. So you can see it's in a text format. It's in a YAML format, they call it, coming from the Python world. And in this YAML format, you can really, in text, describe your metadata. And it's something that you can read in as an object. And then this object is used to render the templates. So the rendering is also quite basic Python libraries to render, to use Jinja templates that render, based on this model, some data in templates. Well, this is quite reviewable. So if you change some one of these lines, it's just one div in your version control system. This is an example of creating the raw tables. So it's a template. But you can see it fills in, there's no thing. It fills in things like your source name. So all kind of standards are actually enforced through these templates. Like you start your database with the environment that you're on. Well, let's use some environment variable for the environment where we're in. And the source name is lowercase, and that will contain your database name. All kind of stuff like this is generated. So and you can do things like looping through some metadata, compare it with other related metadata. So this way, you get a reviewable template, so people who know how to do partitioning, how to create tables, they can review this and they can say, well, we can improve this template by doing it a little bit different. Or that way, we improve our standards for all the teams at once. Another example of loading the core, you can see it's a union, so there's a relationship. We can have multiple raw tables because we have multiple versions of the raw tables, because sources have new versions where they add fields and stuff like that. And in the end, you want to join all these versions together into one core, and the core contains all the fields that are there in all the raw tables. So it's the script to integrate that. But you can see this is an implementation. You can implement it this way, but you can also say, I do it in Spark, or I make a Spark script. We're already having a switch that instead of this script, it's running a Spark script that is doing XML parsing. It's doing exactly the same thing. It gets XML file. It gets even do a mix of XML files and CSV files and join them into the core table. So we can improve these templates as we go, and we can improve the standards that we use as we go. We can change this from being a query into something that is a Spark Python script or in a Spark whatever language script. So we can change the whole framework through these templates. And that's actually the strong thing that we think that we, well, because we have that lot of sources, we really were in need of staying into control of this kind of aspects of all these flows, because else you have to go to all the teams and say, well, you have to do it a little different there, and you have to implement all, do all the release of all your sources. And yeah, it's undoable if you don't work together in a framework like this, to manage it in the way we do it now. And we have a weekly release of new standards, and we publish them we test them every week and run them to production every week. This is a bit of a picture of what we generate in Airflow configuration. So it can create this whole flow of all these sources that are loaded into the data lake. And it generates the flow script. It generates all the tasks that are in it and all the scripts that are needed for it. And then for the BRE pattern, that's where we do this mapping. We enter a lot of this data through an Excel sheet where we map from some input source to an output source, and where we load all these definitions of the input and output source. And this metadata is stored in the repository. And when you use this kind of metadata, you get a lot of dependencies on all kinds of things that need some other source to be loaded and stuff like that. And that's all generated automatically out of the dependencies that are defined in this metadata. So you can see some flow for the BRE pattern. I give a bit of an overview of what we're doing and how we do it, and hope you found it all interesting, and maybe you have some questions out of it. Let me see. Do we use any standards like Data Vault? That's different than the HashiCorp Vault, isn't it? Yeah. We develop our own standards all the time, and we're actually changing it all the time also and improving it. We see it as an iterative way to change the standards that we use. And we look into new tools to introduce like Atlas. Can we use it? Can we fill it in through this metadata with some preset values from the development teams, because I think a lot of stuff should be preset actually through development teams in Atlas instead of being later added to it. And I think it should be part of your whole development process already. That's the way we look at. We want to have it flexible enough to go with the change. Thank you. Sorry? Yeah, it's a bit of history, of course. We were using it, and we started the platform first, actually automating the Informatica jobs, because we got really tired of clicking together all kind of the same jobs. And we moved also, and that's where we decided we have an empty data lake. Well, let's do the whole thing. And we're actually moving more into Spark and into other technologies. We think this is a good way to be flexible enough to be able to move, and that we can generate Informatica XML, but you can easily also generate the Spark code if you want.
Follow-up question. Did you also make developer or Pathfinder?
Sorry?
Did you also make Pathfinder or developer Informatica? Because there's these two variants of the Informatica.
Yeah.
One is called developer, and the other one is called Pathfinder.
Yeah, we actually generate code for PowerCenter. Yeah, the XMLs, the PowerCenter XMLs, we generate them. We figure first out how the flow should look like, and then we have a standard, and then we take this XML, and then we put it in a template, and we generate this whole thing out of the metadata. Yeah.
My question is, if you have to redo this from scratch, let's say new company, everything from scratch, what will you do differently to try to
better things? Yeah, that's a good question. I definitely would go for templating it again, because that's really giving us the power to change everything for at once. Do differently. Yeah, I also always like to use more advanced technologies, and I want to put this also into the streaming area, where we also can define stuff in templates and generate all kind of streaming things on top of this. So, yeah, maybe that that would change it, but yeah, thank you. Yeah, yeah. It is all kind of intervals, actually. We have weekly, monthly, daily, a few times a day. So we can set up in the metadata, like this source, we actually set it as a cron schedule, like it will arrive every day. And that's used by the airflow scheduler. So the airflow scheduler will kick off runs in that interval to pick up new sources. Yeah. Yeah, that's where the streaming-like part comes into place, like where you want to have continuously streaming data ingested in your database all the time, and where you also can specify how that looks like and where it goes, and it's all quite standard. Also, it's some topic, and you want to store it in some database, and you need to map it, and yeah. Well, in the end, it will be like you could from streaming you could create a mirror layer,
yeah.
And then process that further and integrate it into your data warehouse. So that's where we see how it integrates. So it should create some mirror on the Hadoop, and there from there it can be ETL'd into your data warehouse. We're still in doubt, and we don't know. there's a big data manager thingy. It depends. If it gives us benefits, we do it. But we really look at it like, can you configure it from generated code? And that's we really have discussions with Informatica about it, because sometimes the formats are not that open. And yeah, they should open up the standards, actually, and make sure that you can configure it dynamically and have an API or something on top of it that you can use.
So you're looking at something else right now, or look at it in the past, or alternatives to Informatica?
Yeah, we already have a long history with Informatica at the moment, so yeah, that's actually why it's still in use. Yeah. Yeah, you can actually build your own authorization mechanism with it. Storage type, we use that for the data warehouse. We use type 2, I think, mostly. Yeah.
We have all type 1, type 2, type 3. Actually, it's more automatically decided from the information coming out of model. So inside the event model, the data model can decide whether a table should be a historical table with SCD type 2 or a transaction or a event table or SCD type 1. Based on that metadata information, automatically the framework fetch the information and build the historization process. So we support SCD 1, type 2, type 3, and events and transactions. All kinds of patterns are there.
Yeah.
And why do you have three technologies, Hadoop, Oracle, enter data, and so many layers?
Yeah, we also think we can move everything into Hadoop, but our business and everything is still it is a choice. We started off with an empty data lake, and even people discussed like, why do we want to put it in Hadoop? And we said, well, we want to put Hadoop in front of it, just to have everything. And that was already a discussion. So, yeah. We're happy that we're now using it and that we can store all this data in our data lake. And it actually works well, because we get a lot of data, because we force everyone to use this pipeline. That's actually good. Yeah.
So which people are writing these specifications? Which kind of people? What's their background?
Yeah, it is the former ETL developers. So it's really the developers, and we also invite all these developers to contribute to the framework. So like, think about your flows, try to improve it, improve the templates, and contribute to this framework. So that way, the ETL developers get a bit of a different role. Well, they still know most about the real sources, so they know about the source systems and how the data looks like and how to map it. So that's their basic role. But we try to move them into the world of also think about the whole framework. That's a continuously education of all these teams also. That's part of the whole transition.
So could maybe a business person write something like this, maybe a business analyst writes such a specification?
Yeah, he can. Yeah. Okay. Business analyst can write a specification, yeah. And we also make it easier by, well, we just finished the web interface on top of it, that you can start your own web interface that is on top of all these YAML files, and that shows you some information about all the fields that you fill in, because it can be a bit hard to know all these fields and what to fill in to it. And it also helps you automatically filling in some standard steps like connecting a raw core and mirror, that it's automatically already filled in the metadata. So that's what we're improving on.
How long did it take to build all this framework?
We're now 1.5 years busy with it. So, yeah.
Can I ask you how many people are working on the platform automation team?
Yeah, we have one Scrum team that is actually only doing automation for all the other teams, and it's 15 other teams that are actually doing the data stuff. It's about 8-9 people, yeah. But we do multiple things. Like also, it's a bit next to the infrastructure. Well, we're a bit attached to the infrastructure because we think infrastructure and your standards are quite related. So performance and everything, tuning. It's a mix of infrastructure and templates that are the standards. Okay, thank you.